So we're going to talk about children and tobacco. I thought we'd talk really briefly about sort of what are global health goals and how do they fit into this, and then about tobacco and secondhand smoke and their implications for children's health. I hope you're all relatively familiar with the fact that we ended in 2015 the Millennial Development Goals and launched, the UN launched the Sustainable Development Goals, which instead of 8 goals now have 17 goals, one of which is health for all, ensuring healthy lives and promoting well-being for all at all ages, which is a typical UN.
Everyone gets everything from everything, but we've made some real progress in the world with the MDGs. Goal 4, which was reducing childhood mortality, has actually come down by more than 50% in the 15 years of the MDGs. But there are really significant disparities in where the chance of dying still exists. And the darker the country there, the higher the rate of under 5 mortality. And so although we've improved, there's still a long way to go. The sustainable goals are different from the MDGs in a couple of really important ways. There's a focus on leaving no one behind. And the sustainable goals, instead of being focused on the world's poorest or most needy countries, are focused on all countries. There's also an accountability framework built into them, which means that our countries will at least pay lip service to how we do public health surveillance and how we know whether we're improving health for children and youth and families or not. And there's a rights-based approach written into it, which we were talking with one of the seminar classes a little earlier, is basically a dead-on-arrival strategy when it comes to the U.S. government sometime in terms of rights-based language, but in some countries is really important in thinking about how do we move forward in improving the health of people. Now, I want to talk about the non-communicable diseases, or NCDs, because they really lead us into the tobacco control area. And the WHO launched an NCD action plan in 2013, which addresses 4 diseases and 4 risk factors: cardiovascular disease, cancer, chronic lung disease, and diabetes. And the risk factors: tobacco use, unhealthy diets, harmful alcohol use, and physical inactivity. The NCDs threaten human development, they threaten economic development. And if we don't address them, we're unlikely to make progress towards the overall health goals. And it's important, too, in the developing world, in low and middle-income countries, because the rates of NCD-related deaths are rising rapidly, along with the fall in some of the other causes of preventable morbidity and mortality. These have generally been assumed to be a problem of adults rather than of children or of youth. But kids are also affected, and it's, I think, important to recognize. First of all, the population is young. 43% of the total world's population is under age 25. And there are more than 1 million deaths a year from non-communicable diseases in people under the age of 20. It's about 12 or 13% of all NCD mortality. But most of the modifiable risk factors start in childhood or adolescence. When you think about the preventable behaviors that lead to the adult NCDs. And children also have treatable non-communicable diseases, whether it's rheumatic heart disease, or leukemia, or asthma, or type 1 diabetes. The chance of surviving childhood leukemia in highly industrialized countries is well over 95% survival. The chance of surviving acute lymphoblastic leukemia in most of Africa and much of Asia runs downward of about 50%, and that's if you get to care, if the frontline health service recognizes the issue. This slide just looks at the behavioral components from the Health of the World Adolescents from the WHO. Tobacco, physical inactivity, harmful alcohol use, unhealthy diets. Again, starting during childhood or being reinforced during childhood and adolescence, likely to persist into adulthood with negative repercussions both for the immediate period as well as the longer period. And I think it's important to recognize there are actually evidence-based interventions available, both at the population level and at the individual level for almost all of those issues. This slide from the Western Pacific WHO office looks at the proportion of diseases that are due to non-communicable diseases and unintentional injuries. And this, if you look at this, this is the 0 to 25-year-old, and you can see that once you get beyond the immediate newborn period with birth complications and infectious diseases, that the NCDs and injury, especially if you include injury as a non-communicable disease, account for a pretty high proportion of deaths. Now, if you put that in an entire life course, you can see when you run this out to age 70, NCDs account for almost all of the adult mortality. But again, it's not a trivial portion of the childhood deaths as well. So children do require a somewhat different approach. First of all, you need a life course approach. These are not immediately preventable. And there are shared goals here with child survival and immunization and strengthening routine health services and providing universal access to care. So just to make that connection, and then we're going to get back into the tobacco issue. Again, about 1.2 million children and youth dying of an NCD, about 25% of overweight youth have signs of diabetes by age 15. Survival is much worse in resource-poor countries. 90% of the children born with congenital heart disease do not get, that should be inadequate, I'm sorry, because 10% of them have adequate care. And again, the role of smoke there we're gonna get into. When it comes to children and NCDs, the four diseases and four conditions aren't really broad enough to describe what's important for kids. And we've been working through an advocacy organization called NCD Child to address broadening this agenda. So from the prevention side, you have nutrition issues, both malnutrition and obesity. You have tobacco and secondhand smoke, alcohol and drug issues. You have injury, you have mental health, and the impact of early brain development and the prevention of toxic stress as critical prevention opportunities. And on the treatment side, you have treatment and access to care for children with those four diseases, but also with other chronic illnesses, with other special health care needs. And I think that's really important when you think about the impact on a family of having a child with a special health care need. It isn't any one single disease that accounts for the majority of those needs, but whether it's somebody who has birth asphyxia and has cerebral palsy but doesn't die, or whether it's a child who has another rarer condition, it requires services by the family, it requires services in the community to have a system of care. Sustainable Goal 3 has an NCD-related target. So the UN has come up with a whole series of targets and indicators to reduce mortality from NCDs by a third, to strengthen prevention of treatment, to halve injuries, and to achieve universal coverage with access to medicines. The indicators go into a great deal of detail. And there was a lot of advocacy that went into the indicators that we have, some successful, some not. For example, there's no secondhand smoke measure, but there is at least the recognition that NCDs affect all ages. That crossed out line of between ages 30 and 70 was the original proposed indicator for reduction of NCD deaths. So whether we will get good measures from this, I think, remains to be seen. I'm going to skip over some of the sort of what are the indicators that we might think about when it comes to society and the environment. And I want to just say a word about immunization and NCDs, because the story of polio eradication and the fact that we almost have eradicated polio, we're now shifting to oral polio vaccine from oral to inactivated vaccine in countries, is a tremendous public health success story. And I think it's an indication of what could be done to address the elimination of diseases. Immunization is also related to NCDs. Hepatitis and HPV are both cancer prevention immunizations. They're not immediate infectious diseases that kill people with that. So I think, let me just start with sort of that frame as we get into tobacco smoke and smoking as a preventable cause for NCDs. So tobacco causes about 6 million deaths a year worldwide. This is entirely preventable. It's estimated that about 10% of these deaths are due to secondhand smoke exposure, and about 1 out of 4 of those secondhand smoke exposure-related deaths are among children less than 5 years of age. Dr. Samet mentioned Dr. Richmond and the center that we have at the American Academy of Pediatrics, which is called the Richmond Center, after Dr. Richmond. Dr. Richmond was a pediatrician, a developmental behavioral pediatrician who had his early career in Syracuse, New York, and then went into government the first time during the Office of Economic Opportunity and the War on Poverty to start a program that became Head Start, or early childhood education programs. At the time, there were, I think, two sites that had been part of their child development lab that were the model for the Head Start programs. Dr. Richman left us with a great legacy of health planning. He started the process that's become known as the Healthy People planning process, now Healthy People 2020. He also was very important as one of our Surgeon Generals in addressing some of the impact of tobacco on the population and on its health. In his retirement, after his second term in government as Assistant Secretary for Health and Surgeon General, it was the last time that those positions were combined, because afterward they decided that gave the Surgeon General too much power to actually give them administrative oversight over the agency. But in his retirement as an emeritus professor at Harvard Medical School, he was contacted by Susan and Stanley Rosenblatt, a pair of trial lawyers in Miami, who had taken a class action suit against the tobacco industry on behalf of airline flight attendants, who had been exposed as non-smokers to tobacco smoke in the airline cabin, and who were coming down with tobacco-related diseases. And when Stanley called Dr. Richman and asked him, would he please come and testify about the harm and the effects of tobacco, Dr. Richman thought for a while and said, well, okay, and went on to help them recruit a whole range of experts who provided the testimony on the health effects. But that was one of the cases that was able to take advantage of the release of some of the documents from the industry through the discovery process, and was successfully brought to a settlement. And in part, the settlement involved the creation of the Flight Attendant Medical Research Institute, whose logo is down there on the bottom, dedicated to research in secondhand tobacco smoke and its exposure and diseases and prevention. And the flight attendant trustees of FAMRI, as it's known, as they were thinking about what their own investments and legacy should be, after a couple of years of their grant making, decided that they wanted to have a center of excellence based at the American Academy of Pediatrics, because children like the flight attendants in the airline cabins had no voice and no choice in their exposure. And so that led over a much more complicated story than the one I'm telling you, to the center, the Richman Center, being founded at the Academy, and they wanted to name it in Dr. Richman's honor because of his involvement with FAMRI, both during the trial, but then also as the chair of the medical advisory board up until the time of his death. So another one of our Surgeon Generals, Dr. Koop, coined the phrase that tobacco is the only legally available consumer product which kills people when used as intended. Tobacco is also an infectious disease. You get it from advertising, from the actions of the tobacco companies. This image has a car which didn't exist at the time of the rollerblades. This young woman looks very happy and satisfied with her cigarette break there. And of course, lots of times you don't even have a cigarette in the picture because people don't like to be reminded that the smoke is actually really irritating. And so even if you didn't have that little Marlboro pack there, you all would know what this image is. And in fact, kids know the advertisements and respond to them long before they are old enough to smoke. This is not a new problem. In 1604, King James I said, it's loathsome to the eye, hateful to the nose, harmful to the brain, and dangerous to the lung. The Royal Society did an experiment about 50 years later. They fed a cat distilled tobacco oil. It died. It took us until 1964 for the first Surgeon General's report, and it took the WHO until 98 to launch the Tobacco Free Initiative. We had the 50th anniversary of the Surgeon General's report in 2014, and they summed the evidence and what's changed and what we know over those 50 years, during which time more than 20 million people died of smoking, including 2.5 million non-smokers and more than 100,000 kids in the U.S. It's still the leading cause of preventable disease and death in the U.S. And the conclusions from the Surgeon General were that the epidemic is sustained by the industry, which deliberately misled or misleads the public about the risks of smoking. We'll get into that too. What we've learned is that the products are actually more dangerous than they were 50 years ago. There are more than 7,000 chemicals in cigarette smoke. 70 of them are proven carcinogens. Secondhand smoke kills a lot of people. There's no safe level of secondhand smoke exposure and basically no safe cigarette. Just some of the compounds, both the gas and particulate compounds in tobacco smoke. Again, the EPA, one of the agencies that's designated for potential elimination in the new administration, has demonstrated that these are proven human carcinogens. Not theoretical, actually proven carcinogens. Now, nicotine, the addictive drug in tobacco, is really a really efficient drug. That when you smoke a cigarette or an electronic cigarette, the nicotine hits the brain in 6 to 8 seconds after a puff. It stimulates nicotine receptors. Even from a single dose, you generate receptors. Adolescents generate receptors at higher rates than other age mammals. This is not a surprise to the industry. They've known this for a long time. It causes dopamine release. Depending on how you dose yourself, it's either stimulant or relaxant. And again, there are increased receptors in the prefrontal cortex that go along with that, that light up when you stimulate them with nicotine. So poverty and education are some of the strongest predictors of who is actually going to smoke. Secondhand smoke is also a proven carcinogen. Almost half of the world's children are exposed to secondhand smoke. And again, marketing has a huge influence on who actually becomes addicted. This slide just shows the contribution of tobacco to the 8 leading causes of death globally. And you can see it's a much bigger attributable fraction for the cancers and for chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, but still fairly substantive for heart disease, strokes, lower respiratory infections, tuberculosis, adding up to the total number of deaths per year. Globally, about 1 billion men smoke cigarettes, more in developing or low and middle income countries than in the highly developed countries. About 250 million women smoke, more in the high income developed countries than in developing countries, although you'll see that they're catching up there. This is not an area where we want parity to reach men's rates. Somewhere around 80 to 100,000 young people become addicted each day, and it's estimated that 1 in 3 will die from a tobacco-related disease. 80 to 90% of smokers in the world initiate tobacco use before age 18. This is a pediatric disease. In the U.S., about 40% of children are exposed to secondhand smoke. There's no safe level of smoke exposure. There are many missed opportunities for prevention. In multiple surveys, parents say that if they were asked to or advised to, they would make no smoking rules for houses or cars or places where children are exposed. There's also no safe experimental smoking. It's very clear that the old literature that you didn't have to worry about adolescents until they were smoking a half a pack a day for at least 6 months had no basis in evidence. Although all the early guidelines said so, there's both no basis in evidence for that, and there's also, unfortunately, no smoking gun in the document release from the industry to suggest that that was planted. But somehow everybody agreed that that was what you had to worry about, when in fact the later data there shows that as few as 1 or 2 exposures result in cravings and play into the reinforcement of the imagery from media that children are exposed to through their developmental years. So if you think about the behavioral expectancy of what smoking will be like, and you see images of people smoking and it being pro-social and enjoyable, and then you put the addictive drug into that circuit, lots of people wind up addicted very quickly based on the behavior of the drug plus the expectancy that they bring to it. So there's no safe experimental smoking. This is the U.S. per capita cigarette consumption, and that's continued down in most age groups, even through the current year. Although in the last year and a half now, in the last 2 years of data, the rate of youth smoking cigarettes has flattened out. And whether that's because of the e-cigarette component of the tobacco epidemic or not is an interesting question. In Asia and Africa, the industry is aggressively targeting young people and women. the age of initiation is dropping in many countries, so that you have adolescents starting in countries where they weren't smokers, and the per capita consumption in many parts of the world continues to go up. So what happens when you smoke a cigarette in a closed space? It takes about 2 hours for the air quality to return to minimum federal safety standards for carbon monoxide, particulates, and aromatic hydrocarbons. This is just shows you the decay of those measured toxins in a closed room from 8 minutes of smoking a cigarette in a bedroom-sized space. What about the impact of this exposure? Pregnant women exposed to secondhand smoke have more stillbirths, they have more congenital malformations, they have more low birth weight, and they have more sudden infant death syndrome among their babies. So this is really part of the child survival agenda as well. Secondhand smoke suppresses immune response. It increases the burden of influenza, of respiratory syncytial virus, of tuberculosis, of gastroenteritis, and of pneumonia. And it contributes both to severity and also to deaths from some of these conditions. Children exposed to secondhand tobacco smoke have an increased adult risk of lung cancer and leukemia themselves. They have higher rates of heart disease, lipid disorder, and metabolic syndrome, and recent data shows also higher rates of diabetes. And they're more likely to smoke themselves. Now, how much of that is exposure, potentiation of receptors, role modeling behavior, accessibility of cigarettes? All of those factors play into it, but the rates are higher. Tobacco leads to food insecurity and hunger. Adult smokers in Bangladesh and India spend the equivalent of 500 to 600 calories per day on cigarettes or other forms of nicotine. And smoking is associated with food insecurity and hunger in the US and in other highly developed countries as well, from a National Health Interview Survey and other sources. Children exposed to secondhand smoke have lower scores on cognitive tests and worse early school and behavioral outcomes also. We already talked a little bit about the changing evidence for youth in nicotine, that dependence often starts well before daily use, and the behavioral expectancy, mainly from imagery in movies and on TV, account for a great deal of this. Quitting is hard, but still possible. Adolescents are more likely to choose less effective means for quitting. But again, the definition and the surveillance is getting harder and harder. Non-daily, occasional, intermittent, social smoking all has increased, especially among young adults and among ethnic minority groups. So how to measure this and what are the right questions is really part of the challenge. So are we asking the right questions? From a clinical perspective, only 23% of adults in the U.S. who saw a clinician were asked about secondhand smoke. And only 2/3 of adult smokers were advised to quit. This is a pretty strong guideline in everyone's guidelines. In 2015, about 2/3 of parents were asked about secondhand smoke exposure of their children. And only 1 out of 3 parents were advised to keep their homes and or their cars smoke-free. So we have a long way to go to even be asking the basic clinical questions that ought to be part of care. This is the percent of pediatricians who counsel adolescent patients about smoking. And you can see we're not doing too badly with advising to quit. These are 2010 and 2004 data. So the blue bar is 2004. We haven't done a lot better since 2004, but we were doing pretty well there. Talking about specific quitting techniques, recommending nicotine replacement, which is not evidence-based in teens, helping patients find reasons to quit. Again, we're doing a little better. And this all fits into the 5A's Public Health Service guideline. Providing quit materials and referring or follow-up. Again, we're doing quite poorly. We were doing really poorly in 2004. We're still doing really poorly when it comes to how well we provide those clinical services. So let me spend the rest of the time talking about other tobacco products. And especially we're gonna talk about e-cigarettes. Because I know that some of you want to, and because we have to when it comes to what this epidemic means. So electronic cigarettes have been marketed as being safe, having no carcinogens, being harmless water vapor. They could help smokers quit. And actually, none of these claims are true. This looks at the onset of the electronic nicotine delivery system, or e-cigarette use, among adults in the U.S. This is 2014 2014 data from CDC. Ever tried an electronic cigarette? We've got 12.6% of the total population. Among current smokers, 47%. Among recent former smokers, people who were smokers within the last year, 55%. A little bit concerning, 9% of ever users are what we call a long-term former smoker, somebody who quit more than a year ago, becoming re-addicted through this exposure. And 3% of the users, not a huge proportion, but still not trivial, were never smokers. This is high school students from the National Youth Tobacco Survey. And I think the first thing you see is that this is the e-cigarette group from 2011 up through 2015, is you have a huge increase in the proportion of high school students reporting current electronic cigarette use. And in fact, among high school students in 2015, almost 16% of them reported current, that's within the last month, electronic cigarette use. So you have tripling of the e-cigarette use between 2013 and 2014. Going along with some of the marketing. The other thing that we see in this graph is that this is the cigarette use rates, and it dropped, but here, for the first time in almost 20 years, the cigarette rates stayed flat or went up a little bit. And part of that is because what we see with electronic cigarette use is dual use, much more than single product use. Some of the advocates for electronic cigarettes have argued that they will replace combustible cigarettes and therefore they will cause less disease and be good for everyone. And in fact, what we're seeing is that they don't fully replace combustible cigarettes, and they make, from an increasing number of longitudinal surveys, they actually increase the risk of becoming a combustible cigarette smoker. So you have higher rates. So what are e-cigarettes? There's a battery. There is a cartridge of some sort holding nicotine dissolved in propylene glycol or glycerin. And there is a sensor that detects when you're inhaling on it, sending a signal that switches on a heater, which heats the fluid in the cartridge and results in the release of the drug. There are lots of different types. I'm sure you have seen them walking around. This disposable or rechargeable cigarette look-alike, the pen-style large e-cigarette devices and the larger tank style devices. All of the things in this picture are electronic cigarettes, including the one that plugs into your iPhone on the left there. So again, many, many different types of devices. And young people don't necessarily call them e-cigarettes. These can be vape pens, they can be e-hookahs. There are lots of again, interesting surveillance implications. High school students who never smoked but who reported using e-cigarettes at baseline were 2.7 times more likely to start using combustible tobacco after a year compared with never users of e-cigarettes. Adolescents and young adults who never smoked but used e-cigarettes were 8.3 times more likely to progress. So again, the data is really accumulating that they do not prevent combustible use, they in fact accelerate it. So what's in this device? There are sort of three different basic elements. There's the humectant, or the moisturizing agent, there's flavoring agents, and there may or may not be nicotine in the devices. The flavoring agents are generally regarded as safe, or GRAS, by the Food and Drug Administration as foods, not for their safety as heated inhalants. And the safety profile as foods is based on evidence or common use as food additives before 1958. So we really don't have a lot of data on safety. For propylene glycol, it causes eye and respiratory irritation, and the chemical manufacturer states in their product material that inhalation exposure to mist should be avoided. For glycerin, when heated and vaporized, it forms acrolein, which causes upper respiratory irritation. And again, we don't know the long-term pulmonary health effects there. When you heat the humectants, they create carcinogenic compounds. So when you heat them, depending on the voltage and the speed and the temperature, you get formaldehyde, you get acetaldehyde, you get acetone, all formed by heating the solvents. Now, the marketing involved has nothing to do with trying to attract young people to images that involve sexuality or flavors that might be attractive to teens. So let's just leave that alone for a minute. But you know, again, you can see strawberry, snow flavor, mocha, green apple, flavors that are likely to be perceived as sweet or attractive or otherwise moderating the actual flavor involved. Again, having flavors that are available that are seeking the youth market is pretty dramatic here. And we know from the flavoring additives for combustible tobacco products that the marketing there is really driven entirely towards young people. What about the nicotine? So nicotine has complex pharmacodynamics. We've talked a little about that. It stimulates memory and alertness, gives people a sense of well-being, decreases appetite, might relieve minor depression. In higher doses, it increases intestinal activity, creates saliva and phlegm, increases heart rate, increases blood pressure, and in overdoses can lead to seizures and death. Causes nausea and vomiting, abdominal pain, et cetera, a whole bunch of things here. There have been several case reports of suicide by nicotine. There have been 2 child deaths from accidental electronic cigarette juice ingestion that have been reported. Orally, nicotine is about 20% bioavailable. The lethal dose in rats is about 50 milligrams per kilo. In mice, it's about 3. In humans, it's stated as about 0.8 milligrams per kilo. Multiple literature reports of people surviving at up to 6 milligrams per kilo. And a recent review in toxicology suggests the lethal dose is probably somewhere between 6.5 and 13 milligrams per kilo. If you look at the way that the electronic cigarette juice is packaged and sold, 18 milligrams per milliliter or cc is the standard dose form. And 6 ounces of that standard dose is about 3280 milligrams of nicotine. So the toxic dose for a 60 kilogram person is somewhere between 6 and 12 milligrams. Somewhere between 6 and 12 milliliters, 6 and 12 cc's. So about 3/4 of a teaspoon from one of those containers would be a toxic dose for an adult-sized person. The poison control calls have gone up dramatically from electronic cigarettes. I think this past year they crossed the line for regular cigarettes. Children eat regular cigarettes with great regularity. So how much nicotine do you get when you smoke one of these things? There's different bioavailability available through puffing than through drinking. It depends on the temperature. It depends on how much juice is atomized, the droplet size, the depth of the venous absorption from deposits in the oropharynx and upper airway, and you get the small droplets deep into the lungs for the same kind of absorption that you get from combustible cigarettes. The later generations of e-cigarette devices are better at delivering small droplets deeper into the lungs. So what are the health harms? Well, relative to smoked tobacco, it's less harmful. There is no tar and some of those byproducts in the smoke. There is still nicotine. There are still other byproducts. But the comparison really isn't to combustible tobacco. The comparison also needs to be to air. And we'll talk about that in a minute. But compared to no tobacco or medical grade nicotine replacement, there's concern for lung function and the impact of the aldehydes and the carcinogens on the lungs. And there's issues around quality control of the products. The safety of flavors when heated and inhaled is not known. There is an effect on respiratory mucosal immunity that's actually greater than that seen with combustible cigarettes. Alana Jasper's work at UNC has shown that the immune suppression in the adult e-cigarette user is worse than that in the adult combustible cigarette user. Again, the risk of addiction is there, and it may maintain combustible tobacco use, and it's still mostly unregulated. Young adults think they're safer than tobacco cigarettes. And again, this is an effect of the marketing and the attempt to create a scientific debate over this. Everything in this picture is actually an e-cigarette. Those are not crayons. So secondhand vapor is not just water vapor. There's variable levels of nicotine. It's about a tenth of that of cigarettes, but they're still particulate release, comparable in size to cigarettes, and in comparable concentration. And again, there are low levels, but measurable and absorbable levels of formaldehyde and acetaldehyde and heavy metals. And I think the particulates are a really important issue, because what you see when people puff on an e-cigarette is the water vapor. You don't see the particulate cloud that comes off of the devices that others are exposed to. There is surface contamination. Nicotine on surfaces from e-cigarette use is absorbed. It does combine with other substances and forms specific tobacco-specific nitrosamines, just like combustible cigarettes do. Secondhand e-vapor delivers nicotine. This comes from a series of studies by Sharon McGrath-Murrow, one of our center's investigators at Johns Hopkins. And newborn mice exposed to 1.8% e-cigarette solution emissions twice a day for 10 days in a little smoking box that they adapted to fit e-cigarette secondhand smoke exposure have measurable levels of nicotine in their blood. This is not a surprise. When you expose these mice to the secondhand aerosol from e-cigarettes, they also have decreased alveolar growth in their lungs, and they have decreased lung function. And their overall linear growth is affected. So again, the same kind of effects that we see from combustible cigarettes and secondhand smoke are also seen from electronic cigarette secondhand vapor. Now, people will say, well, you don't have data that proves they harm children. I would maintain that if they harm newborn mice, we really don't need to wait to see if they harm children. The presumption ought to be that if they're not proven safe, we ought not to be exposing children to them. The batteries explode, right? You can't check them in your luggage on a plane. They don't explode a lot, but they explode enough. And the harm is not just chemical. They renormalize the image of smoking. In many places, they're still allowed where smoking is not allowed. The advertising remains unrestricted. There were TV ads for the first time since the 1970s. And in ads, they're largely indistinguishable from cigarettes. The marketing uses the same themes that were used by the tobacco industry for many, many years. You have the blue ad on the left and a Virginia Slims ad on the right. They're not selling these using sex, so we don't have to worry about that, at least. Young people are curious about them. They think they might help them not use other tobacco products. They can use them in secret. They don't have the same odor. They're perceived as being safer, and they're perceived as being more socially acceptable. You can vaporize marijuana in lots of the refillable units as well, without anyone knowing what it is that you're smoking. And certainly as we move towards experiments where we have more and more states having legal marijuana products, that's an issue too. So is there evidence that they help people quit? Again, it's pretty limited. Most suggest that people cut down and don't stop completely in this dual use phenomena we talked about. The best evidence there is in highly motivated smokers motivated to quit, that there is a slightly higher rate of cessation for people who self-report using them to try to quit. In the meta-analyses that Stan Glantz and his colleagues have been doing, the collective odds ratio on the 11 studies they included initially was 0.72, and in their latest study is 0.68, that smokers who use e-cigarettes are actually less likely to wind up quitting. So the evidence is not really in favor of them being a good device to help people quit. So what are evidence-based practices when it comes to tobacco control? Increasing price and taxation, because young smokers are much more sensitive to price differential. Smoking bans and restrictions so that people don't get social cues to smoke, and so they can't smoke and they smoke less. Counseling in clinical settings. The 5A is ask, advise, assess, assist, and arrange. Recognizing that this is a chronic behavioral condition that requires repeated reinforcement, not expecting that a single dose of the 5As in 30 seconds is going to change someone permanently forever, although it does work better than not doing it. Having counseling around strict no smoking rules in smoke-free homes and cars as part of that expectation. availability of treatment, both pharmacotherapy, reminder systems, and phone and web counseling and support, and mass media counter-marketing are among the CDC-endorsed evidence-based best practices. From a community and public health perspective, we need to make tobacco control for children and youth a priority. There's a lot of complacency around tobacco. Most of us assume that this has already been addressed in one way or another. 20 years ago, this building would not have been smoke-free. 10 years ago, the restaurants that you go to would not have been smoke-free. There's still a lot of people exposed in a lot of places. The current frontiers there are multi-unit housing and what happens with shared air supply and what happens in outdoor shared settings like parks or beaches, and also what happens with e-cigarettes. The Framework Convention on Tobacco Control globally has made a lot of progress in this area. The U.S. has not ratified the convention because we have an allergy to global conventions that have enforcement powers. But things that are part of that and part of what need to be done anyway include effective age of sale restrictions with meaningful enforcement, advertising limits, eliminating the imagery of smoking in movies, or creating some counter messaging to help moderate its effect, public smoke exposure reduction, not allowing preemption of local or state laws by the industry, and other things that reduce the social acceptability of smoking. What about e-cigarettes? Sales to youth need to be prohibited. Flavors ought to be banned, just like other tobacco products. Smoke-free environments need to include e-cigarettes in their vapor and other clean air rules. And child-proof packaging needs to be required. A couple of years ago, it wasn't at all. There was a very narrowly written federal bill that was able to create an authority that made child-proof packages a requirement because they weren't, because consumer product safety couldn't regulate them because it was tobacco, and FDA had not done its deeming rule yet, and therefore had no authority over e-cigarettes at all. Prevention, screening, and cessation counseling has to ask the right questions about e-cigarettes and their vapor as well, not just about combustible cigarettes. And until we really know more about the anything and cessation, we ought to be recommending medicinal nicotine replacement and quit lines and cessation support, not e-cigarettes for cessation. And in fact, until there's meaningful regulation of the products, any debate over their possible benefit and harm reduction is actually supporting the industry's efforts to delay effective regulation and to addict another generation to nicotine. There is abundant evidence from the early tobacco industry behavior that by creating a false scientific debate, it delays or weakens effective regulation. If you're interested in that, there's a good book by Proctor out of Stanford that reviews a lot of that, and Alan Brandt's book on the tobacco generation also reviews a lot of the history of the industry's behavior. But for example, the tobacco industry spent almost $2 million preventing an ICD, a disease coding category for secondhand smoke exposure, and delayed that existence for about 6 or 8 years at one point over the course of the last two decades. So what can clinicians and child health advocates do? We can ask all parents about smoking and about other tobacco products. We can educate parents about the risks. We can offer treatment or referral, and we can advocate for smoke-free areas and for tobacco control investments. There's a lot more information on our website at the Richmond Center if you're interested in more detail about this. Most of the slides are up there too. You can download them and play with. There are about 1,000 slides up in different decks on the website for people to use either for advocacy or education or otherwise. So where are we in 2016? There are many missed opportunities for prevention of the harm of secondhand smoke exposure. With advice, many parents and adults would set non-smoking rules. In fact, they're more motivated to protect kids and non-smokers than to protect themselves. There's no safe experimental smoking. We need policies to protect adolescents from becoming addicted, especially for e-cigarettes. And tobacco control efforts need to include interventions in child health care for secondhand smoke and for tobacco control for all household members. So can we envision an end game like we've been talking about for polio? Maybe if we're able to be as passionate about this as the global initiatives for polio or measles or HIV or preventable death. The real question is whether there is the political will and whether whether we're willing to take on the financial costs and the conflict with the industry here. I'll leave you with a quote from WHO that tobacco use is unlike other threats to global health. The infectious diseases do not employ multinational public relations firms. There are no front groups promoting the spread of cholera, and the mosquitoes have no lobbyists. When it comes to tobacco, I think all of the reverse is true. Dr. Richmond always used to talk about the three elements that were needed to get to effective public policy. We needed the scientific knowledge, we needed the social strategies, and we needed the political will. I think when it comes to tobacco and secondhand smoke and e-cigarettes, we have the knowledge base, we have the strategies. Whether we have the political will is going to be an interesting part of the discussion. So I think we have to provide that, and we have to try to get our elected officials to hold themselves to what really is in the best interests of children and their families. So thank you for your time. I'd be happy to answer any questions.